sexual advances. Non-consensual sex is criminal behavior. Africa Online, live from Washington, D.C. metropolis, with Asolifan Kemleke and myself, Divine Chiamukong, anchoring. We are on YouTube and Facebook, hence hitting all the four corners of the globe. Ladies and gentlemen, you can participate by dialing 001. That is, if you're outside of the United States, 712-775-7035. And when prompted, enter access code 356613. But hold on, please. Here is Asolifan Kemleke with a hot cup of coffee from a rainy Washington, D.C. metropolis today. Aso?
Good afternoon, everybody. Well, November greetings to all. And, of course, it has been raining all night and all day. And we in the United States had to fall back 1 hour last night. So we lost 1 hour because it is fall and because it is the norm in North America that we turn our clocks back 1 hour. Well, today, Sunday, November 5, happens to be a personal anniversary, not a birthday, but you'll hear about it as we move on. And so, on a personal note, on this November 5, 1977, did you say 77, counting 40 years or something? Well, on this day, on November 5, 1977, began for me a public service career that lasted 21 years, ending prematurely, though, because of mitigating circumstances, a paramount of which was political and cultural intolerance. I was a journalist who spoke his mind, but regarded as belonging to, quote, the other side by those upstairs. Well, a side I have never known and maybe will never know, or maybe present circumstances may let me know. Well, on that day, back then in 1977, I officially began a career which I had trained for in the then International Higher School of Journalism, known by its French acronym, ECG. That was in the University of Yaoundé, the only university in Cameroon in those good old days. One of the first things that I received when I was appointed Assistant Editor-in-Chief of Radio Cameroon was a tract spelling out the so-called Ten Commandments of Achieve. The one that retained my attention was the one that said, le chef ne sort pas son secrétaire, il éduque. Well, the boss does not go out with his secretary, he educates her. From office holders to office seekers, from movie stars to stagehands, from actors to actresses, from school principals to school teachers and students, from television stars and anchors to television presenters and stagehands, there is, in fact, no limit. Careers are ended prematurely by it. Political office is gained and lost because of it. Promising and inspiring leaders at all levels of the social chain walk unceremoniously into the sunset, all because of it. Its victims cut across the social spectrum, all initially unsuspecting victims of one form or other of adventurous sexual escapades, true or fake, intended or unintended, accidental or deliberate, consensual or non-consensual. Musicians sing about it and poets depict it in glowing, sometimes teary verses. I remember in those good old days, J'étais moi non plus, that was a French lady. I remember, of course, those days. Well, journalists write about and comment on its prevalence and devastating consequences. Marriages and courtships end abruptly, all because someone, somewhere, somehow, dared to tease or touch or made gestures at someone of the opposite sex or gender, as they call it these days. Because when you say sex, people think otherwise. Intended or accidental, often a cultural miscue, whatever we call it, human sexuality and sex escapades have become the epidemic of recent years. Sexual adventures come in all shapes and forms, mutual, consensual, non-consensual, the result of enticement, a wink, or an innocent hand or ring or facial gesture, accepted in one culture, but despised and scorned in another culture, totally renounced in many places. Sexual exploits are the result of an assault or outright rape. In fact, sexual escapades have seen the rise and fall of many in almost every sector of human activity. But why, we all are certainly asking. Certainly not for lack of information or education about the social ills and consequences of such harassment. In many social organizations in the West, strict rules exist to prevent such escapades. Where I work as a school district person providing education from the elementary to high school levels, sexual harassment is defined as, and I will quote, unwelcome sexual advances, request for sexual favors, and or other inappropriate verbal, written, or physical conduct of a sexual nature that takes place under any of the following circumstances. When submission to such conduct is made explicitly or inexplicitly, a term or condition for employment, instruction or participation in other school activities, when submission to or rejection of such conduct by an individual is used by the offender as the basis for making personal or academic decisions affecting the individual subjected to sexual harassment, and or when such conduct has the effect of unreasonably interfering with the individual's work and or academic performance, or creating an intimidating, hostile, or offensive work or learning environment. End of that quote. This is not akin to an educational district alone. The language may be different when different organizations talk about or caution against various forms of sexual harassment. Yes, various organizations put in place a zero tolerance policies against such acts as may impair performance, hurt output, and disrupt harmonious relationships at places of work. Unfortunately, those measures that organizations and institutions put in place still fall short of eradicating deviant behavior. The only comforting thing is that at least the institutions are aware of the havoc sexual harassment and all its accompanying subsets caused within such institutions and organizations. But what constitutes sexual harassment? According to my educational district, the following constitute sexual harassment: grabbing, touching, or patting, sexual prepositions, sexually offensive pictures, magazines, notes, calendars, cartoons, or jokes, unwanted flirtations or advances, verbal abuse, repeated pressure or requests for sexual activities, rewards for granting sexual favors, or the withholding of rewards for refusing to grant sexual favors, graphic comments about an individual's body or dress, sexually degrading names, end of that quote. These are in no way all the unwelcome behaviors of a sexual nature. Different organizations and different institutions draw up in-house lists appropriate and specific to the organizations and institutions. In bringing up this topic for discussion this time around, Africa Online in its usual way wants to raise awareness around the topic, seek solutions on the way forward, and help contribute to making a difference on our beloved African continent. So why don't I get over with this and let our discussion begin? And for that, I hand over the microphone to Divine, but not before saying, please, whatever you do, don't let it be, well, the locker room banter, because you either intended it or you really have been dreaming about it. Divine, no banter room questions here. Over to you.
thank you, Songlefan Kemleke, for that beautiful editorial. Someone once said, what the hand executes is conceived first in one's brain. So from the brain, the message gets transmitted to your hands and your feet, and things start happening. And usually things start happening between the boss, somebody in authority or in a position of power, and somebody in a lesser position. Let's talk first about sexual harassment, assault, and so on at places of work, or at school, as you say. Now, the key word, as I listen through your editorial, as only from Kendeke, is unwanted, unwanted, unwelcome. So this is actually the crux of it. Why is it that people, or somebody, just because the person is a director or a CEO, feels entitlement, because feels entitled for certain things from a subordinate? I think this is usually where the problem is. Take a teacher and students. A teacher would not do this or grade the students accordingly until the student is going to yield to unacceptable or unwanted, unwelcome sexual advances. So these are some of the problems. If you just look at the news these days, as only Van Kemleke, in the United States, somebody had to pay $34 million. Can you imagine that $34 million for to somebody, to a woman, because of unwanted sexual behavior? This is incredible. Atole Van Kemleke, how serious do you take this in your schools?
Very, very serious. At the beginning of every school year in September, every single staff, every single parent who wants to volunteer in the school, every single contractor who wants to do work with the school system goes through the sexual harassment and bullying training. It is obligatory throughout my school district, and everybody must do it. If you don't do it, you don't get the job. And if you're a staff and you don't do it, of course, you are shot the way out. So please, it is very, very serious, and I can say it, in the Montgomery County Public School District in Maryland, in the state of Maryland, we take it very seriously. And when it happens, the people, of course, are thrown out. Ryan?
Yeah, but could it also create a very tense environment that you don't have? What are your observations as one of the inspectors? Does it create, or is it likely going to create some kind of tense atmosphere at schools because, you know, people just worry, or for the sake of political correctness, people just, you don't want to even say anything suggestive that could be interpreted or misinterpreted as sexual harassment?
Yes, that is put under consideration, and everybody is aware of what the expectation is. Therefore, don't go there. Don't try it. If you do, apologize immediately, because it might have been a slip. And when you slip and the next day you come and sleep on the same spot, it means you have not learned a lesson. So if you do it today, make sure you don't do it tomorrow, because if it repeats, it means you really have an agenda which you are pursuing. And of course, as I said, you'll be thanked and sent back.
That's very serious, because people have lost their jobs, people have gone to jail because of this deviant behavior. And so, even because there was a story on CNN the other day, or that was, I think, 2 weeks ago, that a young man of about, I think, 17 years took a picture of his penis and sent it to a girl. And can you imagine that this gentleman, this young man, who is still making his way through life, has now carried the tag of a sexual, what do you call it now?
Offender.
A sexual offender. So you see what puts you through the rest of your life. And that's why parents ought to educate, discuss these things in black and white, in no uncertain terms, with their children. That, look, if you do this, it can follow you your entire life. But the question is, African people, African parents, who still see the word sex as something to avoid in home discussions, are they going to take heed? That is the question. Because even if go back to most African countries, even in the media, the word sex, to mention it, it's like, you know, it's the churches are avoiding it, everybody's avoiding it, but the problems are real. The problems are real. Now, in our discussions in the chat room, there were people who said, well, sometimes these things get filtered through cultural definitions. For example, what constitutes a deviant behavior in one country might necessarily not be the same thing in country B. So sometimes too, because of all these cultural interferences, people have come to accept it as just a way of life. Women accept it, well, if my boss required me to go sleep with him, well, it's just everybody does it. So it just becomes okay. So I think sometimes, as Sullivan Kemleke, our cultural setup or settings can be a problem in for women in reporting these things to appropriate authorities. Because you take it to a police station or to a gendarmerie station, in the case in Cameroon, or to some authorities, well, it's just something that everybody just knows. So it's okay. What's your comment on that?
Well, it is not okay in my school district. For example, it was not okay at one of my first jobs I had when I came to this country. I remember a boy, somebody from the continent, being fired from his job because all he did was tell this girl, "I like your boots," and you call them breasts in Africa. He just made the statement. And the girl felt uncomfortable, reported him to the boss, and he was fired. So it is cultural things that we may do or say which are not welcome here. That is the problem. But you have to let people in your organization understand that in my culture we do this without hurting anybody. For example, we Africans are known for hugging. Hugging is it's a very thin line to walk on in my school district. You cannot hug a kid. You can shoulder a kid, but not hug a kid. Because if you do repeatedly, it becomes something else. It is read differently than you and I know back home. We hug our people all the time. It is not bad in our setting, but out here, it is bad. It is the beginning of the temptation that may go further and end up bringing you or putting you in very hot water. Right.
Yes, Ozu, by the way, who is our IT lead, is indicating that he has some questions, she has some questions and comments. I'd like to also inform our listeners that we are live on Facebook and YouTube. We are monitoring all those things. Expertise are building in questions and so on. Ozu, good afternoon, and thank you for all the things you do for Africa Online. You have questions and comments.
Thank you, Mr. Levine. My question is to both of you guys, as far as like you being men, and then I have a comment about the topic itself. So I think I'll leave my question till last. But to comment on particularly the topic in which we're discussing today, I feel like the culture in itself is different. However, if you look at, are we just talking about the situation back home in Africa, we're just talking about it in general as an entire world, because mainly in Africa, it's a man's world. So by that standard, you know, those are things that women have to deal with, would be situations where there's sexual misconduct or harassment or potentially rape, because you're not in positions of power. Those that are tend to use that as a tool to control those that are their victims, or whatever the case might be, whether it be in a work setting or a school setting or even a family house setting. These are things that are prevalent based on who is in power. You know, we've had wars in the past. I mean, South Sudan is the newest country, had major issues with rape being used as a tool of control. Rwanda is also an example of that. And so many different other conflicts on the continent. Those are extreme measures of it, but it's still a problem. So the only solution to it being a problem is, it are we going to look at it as a crime to where it's prosecutable consistently, or is it always going to go silent in the background because people are afraid to confront those that are the perpetrators of such crimes. You know, a lot of people tend to feel like, oh, I can't do anything because this person might be an influential person, have money, and be able to buy off the police officers. But if people continue staying silent when things go wrong, when something does go extremely wrong, then it's an extreme response to that crime, and which might not be the case, which is what you mentioned earlier, where somebody getting paid $34 million for sexual harassment. Sexual harassment is wrong in any instance, but this is an example of an extreme measure of a result of something like that. So my question to you guys as men is that, are there situations that you've seen where you've said something to your fellow guy, if he's the person doing this, or have you seen something where it's a situation you see the woman is the actual aggressor, and how have you responded to that? And then second question is also, what do you think would be a way forward as to deal with sexual misconduct and sexual harassment or assault, particularly even if you don't have female children, or even if you don't have sisters? I mean, you're men, you live in the world, so you encounter all kinds of people. So my question is, how do you feel the right, what should be the right punishment or approach to maybe curving that culture in a way and changing it to be something that's more, you know, a level field for everyone?
Well, Uzo, if I may go first before Divine. Sexual harassment is, as I already mentioned, something very bad that should be avoided. Because if we grow up in society and we do not curb our desires, we're going to always be in trouble. So the best thing is to, as a priest used to tell me when I was in secondary school, see a beautiful thing and go home and give praise to the Lord for creating that beautiful thing. Not think that because you've seen a beautiful thing, you do everything to go out with that beautiful thing. I'm sorry for calling it thing, because I'm just trying to say, if you see a beautiful woman, don't think that you need to own her or go with her or give her a date and so on. Just know that, no. Thank God for creating a beautiful woman. After all, if we were not, if there were no women in the first place, the world would be so dull, and we will not be able to survive as men, or women will not be able to survive as women, because God realized that Adam did not find a suitable partner in all the animals that he had created, and therefore that is why he created the woman. And the woman should be like an embellishment of our environment. And if you have a conscience, you should not think that because I saw Susanna, Anna, Rebecca, I need to go with all of them because they are all so beautiful. You have maybe Jeanette as your own, you got married to that one, forget about all the other ones, and give praise to God for creating beautiful women. Sexual harassment is a real thing and a threat in our society, and we should, as people, human beings, not just as men, but as human beings, men and women, learn or accept the fact that we cannot eat all the yams in the farm. We can only eat the ones that we harvest. And if I may add, if you are a boss, know that you are the head of the household. Know that you are the hunter. Know that you are the family head. And because you are the family head, please forget about hunting in your backyard. Because if you hunt in your backyard, you end up shooting your own goat, or maybe shooting your own chicken, thinking that it was a partridge. Divine? Okay, Uzo, I hope I answered that question. If not, please rephrase it and let me try again. Hello?
Oh, sorry. I was on mute. I'm here.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. I don't know if I satisfied, if I provided a satisfactory answer to your comment and the question.
Partly. The other part of my question was if you give an example of noticing anybody that you feel has been aggressive towards, or has an aggressive manner towards women, or an aggressive manner towards men, because sometimes women don't, I mean, it's a small percentage of the population, but they are those that are aggressors and those that do the same thing, and should be considered, you know, accountable for their actions as well. So I want to know if there's any situation where you've seen where a woman is the aggressor, or in a situation where the man is the aggressor, and what would you, and what have you done as like a personal experience or anything like that? If not, then the question doesn't apply to you, but if it's something that you've heard or listened to somebody told you, just what I want to hear.
Well, Uzo, back in the day when I was in Cameroon, growing up, well, not growing up anymore, I was a journalist, as I said at the beginning of this program. I happened to be given that opportunity to be to manage radio stations. And what I always did the first day of my taking office was to tell staff about being able to be themselves, to avoid those things that could cause them untold problems by avoiding comments that would irritate people of the opposite sex. So I always try to educate staff about the unholiness of sexual harassment issues. It was not called as such. I mean, we always joked about it, but I always made staff understand that talking about body parts, talking about how beautiful or ugly people look is very bad and should not be done at the workplace. People should learn to accept each other as they are, and not think that because this Adam's daughter is like this, I need to do that to her. And I always stress the need for a good dress code so that you don't expose yourself, because when flowers open, bees are bound to go to those flowers to look for nectar. So that was how I handled it. And presently, I work with the school system, and I tell parents at my first meeting with them to also know that the school system has a zero tolerance policy as far as sexual issues are concerned. So I believe I have gone a little longer to explain this or to answer your question and concern. So let's move on. This is Africa Online. Uzo, but I'm not shutting you up. If you have another remark, please go ahead and share it. Okay, this is Africa Online. We're talking about sexual harassment, rape, consensual and non-consensual sex, assault, and so on. These things that make us either feel comfortable or think that we are the heroes and we have survived. Should we continue to do this? Is sexual harassment the way to go? Should we ban it? Or should we, as somebody says, this guy offered $34 million to somebody? Well, give me the $34 million, I will buy an island off of the coast of Victoria and Cameroon and build myself a paradise. So please, let us learn to not do things that will inconvenience not just ourselves, but the people looking on us. Yes, Africa Online, please come in if you have a comment or a contribution to make. We are all ears. Anybody?
Yeah, Nia-san, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Reverend Palm, and welcome. I believe the weather is not as great and wet in Houston as it is here in Maryland. Over to you, and welcome.
It's hot. Our AC is on. And, you know, this topic that we are discussing, this did not start now. Even if we remember, Jacob had a daughter named Dina that was raped. Well, she actually was in love with the guy. You know, but so you could consider it statutory rape. You know, that's rape between a minor and an adult or an older person. But the brothers took vengeance. They actually castrated all those men. They waited. They slaughtered the men. They pretended that I'm just saying that this thing is serious. You know, I wish. Well, I might sound very mean to say I wish that was the penalty for people who rape women or sexually assaulted women. I think if that was the punishment, then we're not going to be having a lot of them. But what happened is that they pretended that unbeknownst to their father, that their sister would marry the support of the wedding, that they wanted those guys to be castrated to go with their Jewish tradition. So when all of them agreed to be castrated, you know, to be circumcised, I'm sorry, to be circumcised. So while they were still healing from their circumcision that same night, you know, her brothers came and they slaughtered all these men just because one of them slept with their daughter. You know, so to me, anybody who rapes anybody should be castrated. That way they cannot do it again. That's how I look at it, because I think it's the most heinous crime against a woman. Then, with the sexual assault thing, this is happening not just in Africa. I know some people say that because of the culture, it's rampant. Being rampant doesn't mean it should, we should continue to accept it. Things are changing. The world has become a global village. So, our women, we need to empower our women and encourage them that they need to speak out. It took one person to speak out about Weinstein before all this plethora of women came out. And some people have been making fun of him, even on the during the Oscar or even on television. Oh, don't go, don't meet the Weinstein in this place, whatever. Nobody, even his friends, there were men in Hollywood that knew what this man was doing, and they just kept quiet. And those are all accessories to this crime. You know, so the fact that it has been happening in Africa for generations doesn't mean it should continue. The fact that teachers find it necessary to give sexually transmitted grades doesn't make it acceptable. The students should stand their ground and document it. In this day and age, anybody can document something and put it on social media. This is going to be called out whether the government takes action or not. When people realize that, you know, their act will be exposed, and a lot of the times these men are married, most of the time, even with jobs, it is not acceptable. But I also remember, it's not just against women. I remember when we were in secondary school, I went to an all-girls secondary school. There was this teacher that was very handsome, a very handsome girl. This girl, they get what? There were students that kept writing him notes. They were turning their assignments. They would put notes, love letters there. To this. It got to a point where he actually went to the principal, a reverend sister, and reported one of the girls. That was sexual harassment by a minor to a senior. So it was only one way, not just a one-way traffic, but this guy, you know, got to a point where he could not take it anymore. He went and reported, and that student was reprimanded. So my point here is that women should not accept it, whether they are here or back home. There are African women that say it here, not just African women, most women, if not all, say, especially by the time they get to maybe 50 or 60, children in the couple come in contact with some harassment or sexual assault, and it's not acceptable. Yeah, sir.
Thank you so much for your contribution. Yes, sexual harassment, no matter the shape and form, no matter the person or whether it's a man or woman, it should be unacceptable. It should be a no-go area. And companies, as I said at the beginning of this discussion, should put in place zero tolerance policies that will prevent this from happening. Because if we do not, then we'll turn our workplaces into jungles, sexual jungles, wherein only the strong will survive. Of course, we don't want that to happen. So we should look forward to putting in place such policies as will deter people from doing it. Whatever you are, whoever you are, please curb your enthusiasm and learn to accept the other person as another, as a co-worker, as a person like you yourself. And you can't do it to yourself because you can't do it to yourself. Don't do it to other people. Accept other people as human beings who want their peace, who want their privacy, who want to be left alone. Because if you don't do that, you end up tripping over and over and being fired from one job to the other. Of course, in the United States, when you are fired from one job, you hardly have another one. And for those coming from the continent to the United States, please, it is crucial to understand that if you do one or some of these things, you get a record, a police record, and the day you are seeking, because you think you cannot go back to your country, the day you are seeking nationality in the United States, it is in your record and it goes against you. It counts against you because your public behavior counts against you and it is negative. So please be ready to accept the consequences of your actions. Is Divine back? Okay, yeah, I thought I heard you. Okay, Reverend Pam, that being said, what are some of the things that people on the continent, because it happens in the continent very often. Like, you referred, I would say this before I ask you the question. You referred to the sexually transmitted MAT. I taught at the University of Boya for three academic semesters before I came over to the United States. And the fact is, this thing became, we coined it in the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, sexually transmitted MAT, because we tried to dissuade those lecturers and other university staff who would make it categorical, who would say it categorically to students, female students in particular, that if they do not submit, their assignments will not be graded the way they ought to be graded. I know that in all universities in Cameroon, male lecturers were always making it difficult for some girls to graduate because these girls did not submit. This is wrong. Sexually transmitted MAT do not qualify a person for a job the next day because they did not learn the material and get the past a subject. So please, let us not do it. So Reverend Pam, back home, I know that we have a particular dress code at home where people do not expose. Here, because of the conditions, the weather conditions, especially in summer, you see people virtually walking the streets, half naked, if not naked. This is temptation in the first grade. So what should people do in such circumstances?
This is the thing. You know, back home, you know, I want to address a couple of things, okay? When you're talking about, back home, people don't dress that way. I'm sure as an instructor, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot here, you probably had some instances where some students thought you were like the other instructors, and they actually try to offer you themselves, not knowing that you are a man of integrity. But a couple of things I want to address, people. I want our girls to know that it is not acceptable and that they have a way out. Because, again, if most people back home have access to the media, I mean, to social media, and they can use that and record it, you know, and expose this student. You say, what can they do here? Yeah, people walk almost naked in the summer or whatever. There is a scripture which is so critical, so relevant to this topic we're talking about. To answer that question, Galatians 5:16. He said, if you walk in the spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So somebody can, let me tell you, I have a brother, I was making fun of him. You know, and my cousin and I were talking. He said, that one, even if a woman stands in front of him naked, he will not even see the woman. So it's a decision. It's a decision that you have to make, especially if you're a married man, or not just any married, I mean, even if you are single. If the woman is not your girlfriend or your wife, you should not even be lusting after them. Because the Bible says, if you lust after a woman, you've already committed adultery. But Galatians 5:16 says that you walk in the spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So whether you see somebody walking with a bikini, not in the beach, they're coming to a restaurant with very tight shorts or exposing their butt or whatever, just turn the other way. You don't have to look. You know, there are women, even in churches, there are women that dress, expose their nonsense, their cleavages with hair, heritage. If you have a heritage, you should be covering it, not showing it to people. Wear short dresses, you know, trying to seduce the preacher. I mean, I'm like, are you kidding me? You think God is not recording it? Unfortunately, there are some men of God that fall for those things. And there are some men of God that, in every denomination, that will take advantage of parishioners, you know? And when I know back home, you know, there were some instances where some of the men of God who are taking the oath of celibacy actually fathered children with married women in the church, you know, the women that in position. So these things are all, you know, seen before God's eyes. But anybody, I don't know if you guys watched the news here recently, there's a young man, he's 17, that is going to prison. For sleeping with a 14-year-old, the girl did not say no. The girl slept with him, but that's statutory rape, you know? And after the fact, the girl came and said now that she did not want it. You know, I don't think at that time that 17-year-old knew his life was going to end up, his actions were going to put him in prison. And he's going to be labeled as a sexual predator or offender for the rest of his life. And there's nothing anybody can do to save him, because that's the law in that particular state that he lives in. So our parents, this thing virtually begins at home. The way people grow up seeing their father treating their mother or treating women, you know, will definitely have an impact on how they treat women or how they respect women. And I will not encourage any of my loved ones to marry anybody who doesn't have any respect for their mother or their sister. Yeah, so.
Indeed, we will not respect anybody who do not have respect for their mother, because your mother is the queen of your life, and you should give her due respect. Of course, the fourth commandment also requires that we honor, we respect our parents, whatever the circumstance. So that being said, this is Africa Online. We are discussing sexual harassment, rape, non-consensual sex, harassment, assault, and so on. Please come in and share your view. Of course, when we talk of harassment, I mentioned in the editorial some of the things that constitute harassment. Merely touching is said to be harassment. Looking at
comment.
A woman in a different way, or look, yes, please, Uzo, go ahead.
This is in response to what was being said already about the dressing and temptation, but I'm on the, how would I say this? I'm on the advocate of saying that that shouldn't be a constitute for a reason why you should commit that crime, because women should feel comfortable in whatever it is they wear. You shouldn't be able to equate men to dogs. Men should be able to behave as men. That means you shouldn't say, oh, well, she's dressing as a slut. So that gives me reason, or constitutes a reason for me to behave that way. You know, it's not acceptable at all. And it shouldn't be. This is referencing to a case that happened on a university campus in Nigeria, where a female student, I think she went to visit one of her male friends, and she was raped by a group of other male students. And the comments about that incident was, oh, well, what was she doing, like, in a boys' dormitory? Why should it matter what she was doing in a boys' dormitory? Are they saying that, you know, women cannot have friends, male friends? They cannot be safe in an environment where they're predominantly males? Do men have to really act as they are very savage behavior? So the aspect of the dress code thing, to me, I don't necessarily agree that you need to stick to a certain dress code. You should wear what you feel comfortable wearing. You should be comfortable in whatever situation that you put yourself in, without the aspect of feeling like you're in danger because of how you do present yourself. Now, that does not constitute or give license anybody to dress provocatively, behave in that manner, and then expect not to have some people respond in that way. But I'm just saying, in general, there has to be some level of, you know, evolving that has to occur in the overall species of the human behavior, as in we should be able to treat each other with respect in any situation, whoever it is, whether you're male or female.
Yes, Uzo, I agree with you. We should respect each other for who they are, and see and pass. Don't see and stay there looking and staring, because that also is a crime. Staring is also considered a deviant way of behaving. Reverend Pam? Okay, anyone on the line to contribute, please?
Sorry, I was muted.
Okay, sorry.
I agree with what Ola is saying. No, the victim can never be blamed. Never. And a child, I don't care how much the child tries to seduce an adult, it will still be statutory rape, and that's why the laws are so clear. The one thing I want to mention, because my dad used to be a prosecutor and a police chief, and he knew the penal code, you know, like in his sleep. There are laws in Africa against this behavior. Believe it or not, there are laws there. That's why you see when somebody, if a young teenager, somebody gets pregnant, the parents will try to get the guy out of that place because they know they'll be arrested. So there are laws there, they're just not being enforced, you know? And we hope that, you know, our government will start enforcing those laws. But again, like I say, we're never going to wait for the government, because a lot of the perpetrators are the government officials themselves. You see ministers, even presidents, you know, having so many concubines, sleeping with whoever. You know, there are some presidents that even kill, if they see your girlfriend, they like it, they will kill you and take your girlfriend. You know, so we cannot depend on them. And now in this country, we have somebody who brags about sexually assaulting women in the White House. And then, so what kind of role models do we have? None. So we need to make sure it is not okay. It's not acceptable. I don't care. And for our men and our brothers, if it's that in the locker room or in your meetings and you hear other guys, disrespecting women or talking about women's body parts or stuff like that, talk some sense into them. You be the big man and talk some sense to them and say, hey, look, don't forget, your mother was somebody's daughter. You have a sister, that's somebody's sister. Let people start respecting women in particular. And for those men who have been exposed to sexual harassment, you know, men that work for female bosses, that make them feel like without them satisfying sexually, their jobs are at stake, I would say don't take it. Got to open another door, don't take it, because that's bondage. That's living in hell on earth. Because I cannot even see myself kissing somebody that I don't love, let alone having sex with somebody for grace or to keep his job. That has to be the most disgusting, the most gruesome, the most heart-wrenching experience ever. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Yes, indeed. I mean, it does not just demean the person. It becomes part of you and lives in you forever. Because, take for example, you are an office employee and you're going out with your boss. What will happen tomorrow when that boss leaves and a new boss comes and you try to behave the same way and that new boss turns you away? Are you going now to resign from that company and go look for a job somewhere else? Are you going to say, oh, but this is a bad guy, and start demeaning that person, start saying bad things about that person? Please. Be yourself. Be conscious of who you are. Respect your personality, and don't make yourself an instrument. Rather, be an instrument of negative talk. Be rather an instrument of positive things happening in your community. You can influence the people at your job by showing an example by refusing to go out with your boss. So don't go with what I said in the editorial this morning or this afternoon about le chef, le sofa, son secrétaire, il est duc. No, bosses do not have to go out with their secretaries. The secretaries are there to work like they and protect the industry or the organization or the office in which they are working. And bosses should not think that because the secretary is right there in front of him, he should do as he likes with that secretary. And if you accept those favors from your boss, or if you give them to your boss, please consider your ways.
Hello,
online. Yes, somebody's saying hello. Please welcome.
Yeah, this is Divine. If I may just ask you a question, and probably Reverend Pam would like to answer this question. Now, some people have also accused women of instigating the harassment. For example, you are a secretary to your boss, to the general manager of the corporation, the almighty general manager who has the power of life and death over you. You come to work with mid skirts, exposing your body. He calls you for an assignment in his office, and you're doing all these sexy sexual maneuvers in front of him. Would you be rightly accused as being responsible for what ultimately happens? That's my question.
Okay, Divine, let me say this. If the lady or the secretary is doing that on purpose, it means she wants it, so it's not sexual harassment. It might be sexual harassment against the boss, but not against her, because she is desiring the boss. However, if the boss doesn't want it, the boss needs to either fire her or write her up or warn her. She's the one that is the perpetrator, so it cannot be considered sexual harassment against her because she desires it. She wants it, so it's not unwanted. But the thing is, you know, we can never blame the victim. Now, we just finished the summer. It's still, I think today is 80-something degrees in Houston. there are people that are going to go to the store with very skimpy clothing. Me personally, I wear long sleeves. You know, that's my choice. There might be somebody that wants to wear strapless. You know, there was a time when I would wear strapless dress to a party. But like I told somebody a story. One guy told me one day, don't wear tight pants because you will be raped. This was in the 80s, and I heeded to his advice because that was coming from a guy. And since then, I don't wear tight pants anymore. That doesn't mean that I am being deprived of wearing something. Like, no, if I know, just like if somebody says, don't drive on the opposite direction on a highway, and you go in there and drive it, and you get into a head-on collision, and say, don't text and drive, you might text and not get into an accident, but the probability that you get in an accident is very high. So once this person told me that was coming from a guy, a friend of mine, I hid it. I'm not saying that, you know, every time somebody tells you, oh, don't dress like that, you should not know. But to me, the idea, just the thought of it scared the living daylight out of me. That was back in the 80s. You know, so we cannot hold the victim. I think you were off the air when I mentioned Galatians 5:16. It doesn't matter whether a woman parade in front of you with skimpy clothes. It says, walk in the spirit and you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. Yes, yeah. I mean, as a man, I don't know how God designed you guys, but I'm sure your organs get up faster than women. You know, well, if you see that this thing is arousing you, turn the other way or start praying or start speaking in tongues. I sent you a funny text the other day. We talked about bitter cola, effect of bitter cola, and some people vouch by it that it's an aphrodisiac. Well, if you don't have a wife, don't eat it. Because you might eat it and it might take you to another altitude that you are not
used
to. Yeah,
somebody
so,
just came in. Let Reverend Pam finish and then we'll call on the person that just came in. Please, Reverend Pam, finish.
Yeah, so that's what we're saying, you know. So I know we took a trip, you know, overseas, and there were four white guys that traveled with us, and I got them to eat bitter cola. Back then, I didn't even know that this was part of the benefits of bitter cola. And one of the guys at the meal told them that, oh, this thing, you know, it's a sexual aphrodisiac. And then one of the guys said, thank you so much for giving me this when you know my wife is 8,000 miles away. So if you know that you eat this stuff, it's going to arouse you, and you're probably around women, beautiful women, you're exposing yourself. That doesn't mean you cannot control yourself. You can always distract yourself. There's no excuse for raping anybody or sexually harassing anybody, and especially the person has already brought it to your attention. Right now we have a case, there's a case going on in Houston here. I want to encourage any African woman, because I know our women are very timid. If anybody harasses you, call them out. There are people, I don't care who they are in society, there are people that when they say something, the society will gang up against them and say, ah, we want to bring this man that we want to bring, and then the wives will go after the girls, not even their husbands. Please, look, if anybody sexually harasses you or even rape you, call them out, call the authorities on them. I don't care if they're from your village. Over to you, Mr.
This is Africa Online, and we're reaching you live from Washington, D.C. metropolis. Hartsong, Lefan, Kemnitz, Reverend Pam in Houston, Hartsong and myself in Maryland, Washington, D.C. metropolis. We have this show going on live on YouTube and Facebook. Apparently, we're having people getting on the line, I guess, with questions or comments. Anybody with a question or comment at this point? Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Yes, please.
Thank you, Gorgi. How are you guys doing?
Hi, Dr. Gorgi. How are you? Dr. Gorgi, I have a question for you. You are from Nigeria. Yes, you are from Nigeria. How rampant or not is sexual harassment, rape, assault in Nigeria, is it?
I will say two things. Rape and sexual harassment is common. It's common. On the other side of the coin, we have to be careful. What I like to differentiate rape, sexual harassment from inappropriate sexual behavior. Whereby, took example is a rape is a forceful have a carnal knowledge of a woman is raped. That is wrong, 24/7. It doesn't matter if you're your wife, your girlfriend, whoever she is, you cannot rape somebody. That's completely wrong. Sexual harassment to me is trying to make sexual advances to somebody. You are who is supposed to be a subordinate. You are the boss, you are a secretary, you are junior staff, you try to harass them and use your position to obtain sex from them. That is absolutely wrong, and that's very common in Nigeria. I mean, when young ladies want a job, you know, they mostly believe that they have to have sex to have the job, which is wrong. That's completely wrong and useless. So, number two. But the other one whereby I have a problem with is when a young lady herself put herself in the place of enticing a man to have sex with her because she wants something, or they are making the proposal. This is very common in our universities. It's a two-sided thing. Some university teachers or professors want to sleep with the girls to give them mark and intentionally fail them to give them mark. That's absolutely wrong. So no teacher should sleep with the daughter with the female student for math purposes. He should lose his job right away. On the other hand, what happens when a girl fails an exam and go back to a teacher and start moving and winding her bottom so that can tell the woman and meet her to get marks? It's wrong too. The men supposed to control themselves. It's absolutely wrong, but those women should be also brought into court order. So, that's what I'm trying to drive at here. I'm a firm believer in protecting women and the vulnerable and the young people that are a problem. But also be a firm believer that when the victim in court becomes the perpetrator of the fact, they should be disciplined adequately. That's what her problem. Why am I saying this? Recently it was a news that George Bush sexually harassed a woman. I mean, it was on the news, and the man apologized for holding the actor on her bottom and everything. If you know that you want to go take a picture of George Bush, who's 93, and he always puts his hand on her phone, don't go close, move away, don't stay there after a picture and say he rapes you. For me, that's wrong. So, I mean, I have a problem the way things are defined in this part of the world. They try to protect the victim all the time.
I asked all of you a question. There was this court case, Kobe Bryant, you know Kobe Bryant, who is the same basketball player. He went to a hotel, the kid was in court public. He went to a hotel. The person, the lady, the young beautiful woman who came to serve him in the hotel, somehow began a sexual encounter with him. Now, listen, after it was all done, this woman, days after, went and filed, raised an alarm that Kobe Bryant raped her. The question in court, the judge asked, "Madam, did you yourself put down your pants, what we call in Africa, trousers?" She said, "Yes." "Did you climb on the bed?" She said, "Yes." Then the judge asked, "Can you therefore explain how Kobe raped you?" Here's what she said. She said, "Kobe started the penetration, and at some point, she said no, and Kobe will not stop. Now, this is like a force of gravity. Isn't it like asking or trying to stop a piece of rock that you yourself threw up is coming down, you're trying to have it go back up? I want your reaction on this." Reverend Pam.
Okay, and it's fine. I'm glad you brought that up, and I'm gonna address that, but we are at the top of the hour.
I didn't notice it. Go right ahead.
Yeah, we are at the top of the hour, so we're going to announce our next topic. And I know for a fact that these topics are making a lot of difference, not just in the motherland, but among Africans here in the diaspora. Our next topic is a topic that every single African has been affected by, either directly or indirectly. You know, back home, even in the schools, right from primary school, kindergarten, most students experience bullying. They are bullied everywhere, from primary school, kindergarten, all the way to university and graduate college. It happens in Africa, and even here in this country. You know, There's been a lot of students here that have committed suicide because of this bullying in schools. So our next topic is going to be bullying. We're going to be talking about bullying, not just in schools, even at the workplace, you know, all kinds of bullying. That's what we're going to be tackling. And we are believing God that, you know, it would wake some people up. And some of our children, we parents, we need to tell our children, because some of us, our children are the ones doing the bullying. Our students are the bullies. You know, so the fact that you have a fancy car to drive to school doesn't mean make you any better than the car or your classmates who can barely afford lunch. So we're going to be tackling bullying next time. I need divine come to you. If this girl was having sex with Kobe, none of us were there, did she say, and at some point she said no, he needed to stop. Even if he could not control himself, he needed to pull away. You know, and I don't know if the girl pushed him, excuse me, or just stopped, because if the girl pushed him, let him go to the bathroom and finish his affair there with himself, you know. But if somebody says no, it doesn't matter whether they said no at the beginning or at the climax, you need to stop. If you continue after no, it's rape. That's my response to that.
Can I say something?
Dr. Bujo, as long as I can look here, isn't it also possible that some women would use this as, oh, kind of like somebody says, weaponize sex? You climb on the bed. Now, this guy, you know, is a wealthy guy. I mean, you know who this basketball player is. Could it also be that the woman, you know, we find the case, you're just trying to see scenarios. Could it be that some women would try to use this as a trap, lure the man in? When the man is about at the peak of event, heat of it, said no, stop, knowing that it's going to probably happen, man, stop. Your reactions, please.
Yes, before I take before I say something, I think Uzo had something to say in reaction to what Reverend Pam said. Uzo?
Yes, Uzo.
Yes. My question, comment on this is not necessarily to shame the victim, and that's not the intent here, but I just want to play devil's advocate on this, just because I feel that when it comes to celebrities and basketball players and football players and all that, part of what you hear and part of what you see, I mean, if you actually talk to some of them, they'll tell you that it's almost as part of it that there's this entire movement to as them as targets in a sense, you know, you'll be surprised at how men tell you that women look to just having their children as a way of getting like a pension plan set up. And as funny as that sounds, it's actually a reality. So in a situation between Kobe Bryant and that young lady, we weren't there. I don't think we can ever know for sure what really happened between both of them. She could have said yes, in the middle of it, I said no, but that could be a fabricated lie just to get something out of the situation. Because to me, in my intent, you know, the understanding for rape or sexual assault is something that is unwanted, right? Whether usually before it even occurs. So, but you're telling me that you willingly went there and you willingly engaged in that activity, and then halfway through you changed your mind. I think that's a little bit insulting to the people that are listening to it or people that are hearing it. And I'm not saying that it didn't happen, and I'm not saying that he's 100% not guilty for what he did. But I'm saying, if you're going to put yourself in that situation, that means you already knew in your mind what you wanted to get out of it.
Can I comment too?
Yeah, what you wanted. I'm almost done. Sorry. What you wanted to get out of it, and it's something that is very. I mean, they had an entire show about football players and all the nonsense they go through, and how women will do whatever to either have babies by them. Even in a sense where you never actually slept with the woman, but somehow you are pregnant, she's pregnant with your child because she has paid somebody else to have sex with you, and then get your semen to use it in insemination. So there's so many different dynamics when it comes to sports celebrities and other cases. There's so much targeted from so many different angles that when they do commit a crime, sometimes it's not believable by the public that they're capable of doing that because they should know better. But I'm just saying, in this instance, he was tried in a court of law and was deemed not guilty, but at the same time, we will never know what transpired between the two of them, because to me, I feel like if you said you willingly went there to engage in that activity with him, then you obviously knew that this is what was going to happen. It's kind of like saying, I mixed red and blue, and I'm surprised I got purple. I mean, that's what you're going to get.
Okay, basically, I totally agree with Uzo. You don't keep yourself, women should not put themselves in position to make somebody want to have sex with them and eventually turn around and say it's rape. I don't agree with that. During the elections, people can kill me if they want. During the election, in my environment, we talk about Donald Trump and all his escapades. I'll tell them, if any of those young women met Donald Trump in Trump Tower and eventually have sex in his hotel room, they are as guilty as him. Because I won't allow my daughter or my sister to go meet Donald Trump in a hotel. So it's not meeting in the office, not inviting to come away. So basically, if you have money, or a football player, businessman, you have to be very, very careful. But the law should find a way to make people accountable. So if a young lady, don't go and meet Trump in his hotel room, because he might rape you. He's not right. As soon as they're punishing Trump for doing what he did, they should punish a young lady who went to meet in his hotel room. People can kill me for that, but that's the way I look at it. So, basically...
Why are they punishing the young lady for?
Why should a young lady who wants to be in the beauty show go and meet Donald Trump in his hotel room? Tell him no and call the police and say, you're going to my hotel room. You should protect yourself. You should protect yourself. As a lady, when I was growing up, okay, personally, when I was growing up, okay, I cannot let a woman come to my bedroom and I close the door if I don't want anything with her. And a woman should not come, I mean, I'm just saying, basically, you know, if a woman comes to your bedroom in Africa, you share one room and stay there and you got to close the door and start trying to have a drink. Anything can happen after that. So, a young lady should not go and meet any businessman in his hotel room for business, meet in his office, as secretary. So you should preach this. While we're trying to protect them, we should explain that people should learn to protect themselves. You know, the laws in this country are great, but they are very, very one-sided. That's why I look at it.
Divine, this is Barney. I just called in late. I just want to thank everybody. I haven't been calling in due to schedule conflict. I'm very happy you guys handled this topic very well.
Okay, I have a contribution which came in from Marwa, far north of Cameroon, from Dr. Ngem Leonard. Here's what he says, and that kind of thing is in sync with what Dr. Gotti just said. In Africa, where I lived in places where the popular belief is that any lady who accepts to pay you a visit in your room as a single has indirectly consented to whatever follows between both of you when you are together in that room. They will never ask you to do anything, but will encourage you by their gestures and behavior. Most often, guys who fail to act are labeled weak or even nicknamed. Certainly, someone who grew up under such conditions would find himself in great trouble if he tried doing this elsewhere. I wanted to rape, and this is the thrust of his condition. I wanted to rape as well as, the thing just went off, but I'm going to get back to it. The bone, the meat of it is, Reverend Pam, I'd like you to address this, is rape defined or filtered through cultural definitions. In other words, one thing that's rape in Cameroon is not the same thing as rape in Africa.
Divine, thanks for the question. Rape is rape. And like I mentioned, I think, I don't know if you were on the air at the time or not, there are laws against rape, sexual assault in Africa. They're just not being enforced. So rape is rape. The definition is not different. However, there's a more awareness here in the U.S. Think about it. See how long this nonsense went on at Fox television with, what's that, I don't need to remember the first name, the founder of Fox, before it ever came to the light. And then now, you know, it's like Pandora's box has been opened with Hollywood. There is one celebrity after the other now, and I know Jesus is on his way because these things have been going on for decades. So rape is rape. The definition is not different anywhere. However, people can interpret the laws. I know, you know, there's civil law, there's common law, and all kinds of laws. It depends on the laws of those countries. You know, for example, with the civil law, if somebody accuses you of rape, you are guilty until proven innocent. With the common law, if they accuse you, you're innocent until proven guilty. So rape is rape. It doesn't matter. But I wanted to make a comment about what our brother just said. You know, you see, it depends. There are people, depending on the kind of business, there are some people that you have to meet them in a hotel, not in a hotel room, maybe in a hotel lobby or something. However, the fact that somebody goes to meet somebody at a hotel room doesn't necessarily mean that they're expecting to be raped. It doesn't mean that. A lot of these actresses are saying that when they met this guy, who was the owner of Miramax, power, he could destroy your career. Where the people that did not hit to his advances, he destroyed their career. They picked people, tabloids, to go and dig up stuff and private investigators, and they destroy you forever. So even though some of those girls gave in, those were non-consensual sex. You know, that was, they felt like they had no choice. So it's not like, oh, they went there and they should have expected it. No, it's just a man in power, a man in authority, abusing his power and his authority. And that's unacceptable. Again, I want to encourage our women in Africa, our men, whether you are a boy or a driver, don't sleep with your madam. Please, don't. If your madam... let the husband know. Yes.
I have a question for you. Now, isn't it unfair to only think that harassment is when the man is launching some unwanted advances towards the woman? Does it happen the other way around?
I just said that.
I missed it.
No, the last statement I made was that if you are a housewife or a driver in Africa and your madam is harassing you, you know, even Joseph in the Bible was harassed by a Potiphar's wife and actually put in jail because he refused to sleep with Potiphar's wife. Potiphar accused him of attempted rape and he got thrown in jail. There are drivers and houseboys that have fathered children of their madams, and they sleep with those madams not because they're attracted to the women, but because that's their madam and they need the job, just like house girls. You know, and so it goes both ways. There's more rampant with women. And that's why I'm saying that if anybody, I don't care if it's a male or female, your employer or your minister or your teacher, it's not acceptable. It's never been acceptable. Use social media, record them. So, you know, if you think that you need that job, you cannot stay with a job. If you report your madam to the husband, the husband will give you a job and thank you for telling him that his wife has been wanting to sleep with you. That's my take, Nate Divine.
Yeah, just to follow up, anybody can react to it. What would you say, Reverend Pam and gentlemen, to take the case in Africa or cases in Africa where you badly want a job, and that's probably the only opportunity that is in front of you at that time? You know, you're a woman, you know, if you didn't take it, well, another one will take it. It seems to me that the circumstance that drives women into sleeping with people they did not really, really want, but because of one, the scarcity of job, the economy plays a role. What would you tell that woman? Who would tell you, well, Reverend Pam, easier said than done, it's easy way to say it, you are in the United States and probably have other opportunities. What do you tell that poor girl in Africa running around the streets with no job, and then this is the only opportunity that is in front of her?
Reverend Pam, just let me say this. Where is your conscience? Joblessness
does not mean you debase yourself to the level of giving it to the man before getting the job. If you are qualified, build and stand on your qualification. Don't give in just because you are desperately in need of a job. And something else, a window will open somewhere else if you do not succumb to the demand of the man.
Let me say something here. First of all, if this man is asking you for sex, know that he's been sleeping with every other woman and he's having some kind of sexually transmitted diseases. So you need to ask yourself if your life is worth more than that job, or you know, if you're gonna just open your legs to somebody that you don't care. Another thing is that you don't have to have that job. You can go do. There are university students smoking fish and selling in Nigeria. There are university students working farms. You don't have to sell your body, my dear. If you have self-respect and self-dignity, you will not do it. It's just like somebody saying that, okay, you have to bribe to get a contract. There are people who don't bribe. I do not bribe, and I've done business in Africa. So I'm sorry, that's not a solution. Because this man, and if you sleep with him, just be prepared to sleep with him every single day you go to work. That's my answer, I need to believe.
Now, question again. Let's take a flight to Southern Africa and North Cameroon. Bonnie, Dr. Ogoji, probably to Northern Nigeria. If you go to Southern Africa, most traditional dances, women dance with, you know, bare chested, their breasts bouncing and so on. Now, that same situation, first of all, it wouldn't even arise. Tell me what happens if Southern Africa, North Cameroon, Marwa, if that happens there, that you begin to have advances from men. The question actually is our culture playing a role in facilitating some things that we are denouncing here?
Well, Divine, I lived that situation when I worked in Marwa. It happened at the airport. The president came for the agricultural show, and there was this group of tribal girls. They had to dance bare-breasted. And they had loins on, but when the president approached, the loins fell off, and the boots came shaking all over the place. We quickly continued to report because it was live on television, and the president quickly walked by, and of course, after that, the girls put on their loins and went their way. The fact is, people have to learn to have self-control. Seeing should not mean touching, and that's the way they put it in the north, in North Cameroon. They say seeing does not mean touching, because if you touch, there is always a gorilla-looking guy hanging around. If you touch, you are beaten to pulp. So please know that if you touch, there are consequences. So please learn to curb your enthusiasm, learn to curb your desires. Please have self-control and forget about the beauty. As I said in this program today, learn to pray and thank God for creating such beauty. Reverend Bram and everybody else.
I think it's well, any direct to Bonnie and Dr. Goji, so let them
okay,
go in.
All right.
Okay. Well, what I want to say is it's true that you have to learn to control yourself, okay? I was in a nightclub about last week, 2 weeks ago, just hanging out, having a beer. A young lady approached me. I said, are you surprised to see me here? I was shocked. I don't know her. As we get talking, she was one of my patients. So in a much as I wouldn't mind dancing with people when I go to club sometime, I stay far away. I said what? Far away, because I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I said, nice to meet you. I'm off. So that's the standard, the standard of people, everybody in society, not just me, everybody. But again, that young lady in question came to us and I said, can you buy me a drink? I said, no, I don't buy drinks for people.
Thank you.
I don't buy drinks for people. Because if I buy a drink for her, she won't dance with me. Maybe just dance with me, I may be in trouble. And you don't give a room for people to say something happened before you are proven wrong. You know what I'm saying, sir? But at the same time, we should find a way to protect the victims, we should not only make the victims to be truthful. The case of rape and sexual immorality is very the same, is very equivalent to a case of domestic violence in this country. A woman can beat a man up 24/7. And I'm not changing the topic, okay? The police come in there and the woman say, the man beat me, okay? If they find the woman was telling lies, she will not be arrested for telling lies. Because they want to tell other people from coming up to complain if it happens to them. But if the woman say, man beat me up, get finishes. Get to the steps.
Now, Dr. Goji, hold it. Let me do a follow-up for Reverend Pam to answer. Now, Reverend Pam, you are a CEO of a company. Now, in your company, do you prohibit love relationships between, especially directors or your chiefs of service with their subordinates? That's my first question. Second question is, if a woman came to you and said that she's been harassed by one of your people in hierarchy, how do you establish truth in that kind of situation?
Okay, yeah, thank you for the question. We do have, we call it a non-patronizing clause in our employee handbook. You're not supposed to date anybody at work. And I actually had a situation where this technician lost, her brother was shot himself in front of her. And she was so traumatized, so the people at her own location, they contributed money. I also contributed. But her supervisor cared so much about her, went and visited her a couple of times, and even paid her light bill, and she misread that as if the guy was in love with her. So I'm telling you, it got to a situation where I had to stand on the word of God to resolve this issue, because I thought I would have had to get the police involved. Thank God I didn't need to. She basically sent me letters accusing this guy of, sleeping, not raping her, but that this guy promised her that he loved her, the guy took advantage of her, all that kind of stuff. I don't know if the guy had sex with her or not. I really don't know. Maybe it happened. I don't know. I wasn't there. She did not claim sexual harassment or rape. She just said that the guy was cheating on her, and this guy said this girl is mental. So that's why, because the guy was being kind to her after she lost her brother, she misread the signal and thought the guy was interested in her. And the guy said he was not interested in her. So those things happen. So we need to be careful, men and our sons and our brothers, be careful. Stuff like that, he should have taken another female employee with him when he went to visit her. But maybe he didn't know. Again, I don't condone dating on the workplace because, first of all, it interferes with performance. So we do have non-patronizing clause in our employee handbook.
So, Reverend Pam, it means that, if your workers are probably never going to find a person after your work.
I'm sorry?
It means that your workers, your employees are never going to have or find wives or husbands at job site at your work.
It's not a nightclub or a dating place. No, they are not allowed to do it. Yes, they'll have to find it somewhere else.
Well, if you go over to Assembly San Kemleke and Dr. Goshen Boni and the rest, probably the same thing is the same thing, thing for guys in the United States to do is don't be the person to start. If the woman wants you, I tell you, when the woman wants you, she will go after you. She will throw banana peelings around you. She will even be the one to try the blood. She will not even be the one to appreciate it. Dr. Good.
No, I understand what you're saying. You don't go after a woman, even your wife. Make your wife want you. Don't go for her. Don't go to her. Because you might be in trouble. In America, a wife can rape the husband. You know that. So can rape a wife in America. So every woman, let them make the move first. Period.
Remember, in some of the previous editions, you said as a minister that the Bible says it's for the man to go after the woman. You hear the situation that men are not wanting to make a problem.
No, see, it's fine. It's in Proverbs 18:22. It says, he who finds a wife family is putting on Kenneth's table. I'm not talking about after they get married. That scripture is referring to that women should not go marry or go ask a man to marry them. But if you are married, my dear, if you're a wife and you're listening to my voice, if you pick a man and your husband is lying there, like, you do whatever you need to do. I'm not inside your marriage. I'm not going to tell you guys who should start. The woman can start, the man can start in marriage. But before marriage, the man is the one that's supposed to find the woman, not the other way around. That's what we're talking about, courtship. We talked about that last year. But so, Dr. Ogoji is saying that, you know, I'm sure there's some wild honey women out there, some wives that, you know, they have to have this force. So, a husband and wife, the two of you agree on what you do in your bedroom or in your kitchen, or whatever you guys do, it, that has nothing to do with me. Then before marriage, the man has to, that's Proverbs 18:22.
That was a good one.
I don't want them to come and say, I understand, so they should not, my dear. By all means, whenever you want to put it in the pin, your husband and whatever, go for it. That's between the two of you. That's nothing to do with it.
All right, it's getting really, really heated. But unfortunately, we have just 3 minutes to go. Antoine Fankimleke, you've been quiet.
Yes, I've been quiet and listening and enjoying the conversation. And I think that, as I've said all along, conscience should be the final judge. Is what I'm about to do, or is what I'm doing, the right thing to do? Is it the best way to keep my job? Is it the best way to serve my community, or serve myself and serve my people? Please don't yield just because you think that you're going to get satisfaction. But how long does that satisfaction go? It is instant. It may last just half an hour, and it's over, and you'll never get it again. So then after the relationship, what next? What do you do with that person? So please, if you are going to go with somebody, be ready to go forever with that person. That is my take on that.
Dr. Ogoji?
I totally agree. Basically, conscience should be with the guiding principle. Men, be careful, because men are always the troublemakers. While women, be careful too. Don't expose yourself to some men that might take advantage of you. If you don't want a man, make sure you don't meet him with him in a closed door. Meet him in the office. If you're a high-rising man, if you're going to have a meeting with a young, beautiful lady, have a chaperone with you. If I'm a football player, if I'm a CEO in a company, if I'm meeting one of my junior staff, I make sure somebody else is there. Because I want protection. I don't want to be accused.
We have to leave the next few scriptures. So, Reverend Pam, the last word from you.
Yeah, my last word will be a couple of scriptures. You know, I talked about Galatians 5:16. To those who are being tempted, you say, walk in the spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So if you're a man and somebody passes by you almost naked, please don't even bother. Start speaking in tongues or start praying. And then in Acts 24:16, it says, exercise yourself so you should have a conscience void of offense toward God and toward man. So don't do anything that will be offensive toward any human being or God. Over to you, Nathan.
Thank you. And it's on that very positive note that we've come to the end of this week's broadcast. Come in, join us next week at the same time, 3 p.m. Washington, D.C. time. Now, 9 p.m. in West and Central Africa. Now, 10 p.m. in Southern Africa for yet another edition. And the next edition, as you heard, will be on bullying. My name is Divine Champion. As Sonny Fankimleke joins me in saying goodbye, and do have a fruitful week ahead of you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.